When a child has the loss of a parent, it changes their life irrevocably. While we often comment on how resilient and adaptable children are, the loss of a parent and the impact it has can reverberate across that child's entire lifetime. We're discussing this today as part of Radio 2's Grief Conversation season because we think it's important to talk about grief, however difficult that might be. With a child, that conversation could mean the difference between them covering up their pain or getting the support that they really need. Perhaps you're someone who lost your mum or dad when you were just a child. If you'd like to tell us how you think that loss has shaped your life, you can email us on Vine at bbc.co.uk or send us a text on 88291. You may also be supporting your child as they grieve the loss of their mum or their dad. And I'm joined on the programme by Claire Richman from the children's bereavement charity Grief Encounter. In a moment, she'll give some advice about how to support a child who's been bereaved. But Claire, good afternoon to you. It was your own experience that brought you to this job in the first place, because you lost your mum when you were only 5 years old.
Yes. Hi, Vanessa.
Hi.
Thank you for having me on the show. Yes, my mum was diagnosed with breast cancer when she was about 37. So I was just 3 years old when that was happening. She had surgery, dramatic surgery, and then treatment, which worked for a while. But then it actually came back. And by the time it had come back, it had already spread throughout her bones as well. So what was breast cancer then turned into a massive onslaught. Funnily enough, we went down to stay with some family by the sea where she grew up, and she actually passed away when we were there. So not only was my dad dealing with sort of compounding grief, but also shock that it happened quite so quickly.
Gosh, how absolutely devastating that must have been. But you were only 5 years old. How many years ago was that, if you don't mind my asking?
I don't mind. It was 32, 33. I'm 38 now.
All right. So 33 years ago.
Yeah.
And when you think back to it, do you remember the moment that you were told? And can you remember how you felt when you were such a little girl?
Yes, I remember it vividly. Like I said, we were away by the sea where my mum grew up with some family, and so obviously we were brought back, and we were at my grandma's house. And I remember there was a sort of very strange atmosphere when we arrived, and my dad was obviously very pleased to see us, and he sort of sat us down by the stairs. He was sitting on the stairs. And just was very honest. My dad was always very honest with us. And he said, look, you know, mummy's been very unwell. I'm so sorry to tell you, but she actually died. And he used the word died, which back in those days was really quite brave.
Yes.
Even nowadays, people don't really like to use that. People, you know, for lots of reasons, say the word lose or loss.
Mm.
You know, we're not careless. So I didn't put her somewhere. It's really important to say the actual word, and my dad was really brave enough to say that. And I remember at that moment when he said it, being only 5 years old, thinking, I don't really know what's going on, but this must be bad. I must have done something wrong, because he got very upset, obviously, after he told us.
Yes.
And he kissed us all on the head, on our foreheads, which is something he always did when we were being very good. But in that moment, I remember thinking, I must have done something really bad. And, you know, when you're 5 years old, you just don't have the language to understand what's going on. You don't have the maturity to cope with your feelings or even identify what those feelings are. And actually, my first instinct was actually to laugh, because, of course, what do you do in that situation? You don't really know. And I think I sort of let out a bit of a yelp or a laugh or something. And then I genuinely don't remember anything else about that moment.
Do you think you grasped then, or did it take you some while to grasp it, that she wasn't coming back, that you weren't going to see her again in the way that you had before?
Yeah. Well, I mean, again, this was a long time ago in terms of treatment and sort of the sort of taboo around the subject. But all those years ago, people weren't given the support that they needed. And so at the time, my dad thought it would be a good idea to take us along to the hospice where she had been and actually see her. Now, that's quite a controversial thing to perhaps do, but that was what he thought, and I support that he thought it was the right thing to do, and sort of to provide in a way a sort of closure and a kind of understanding about actually the certainty of the situation. But I can tell you now, as an adult, it was completely traumatizing. It really is quite a vivid image in my mind, and I can easily get triggered and think back to it. And so throughout my childhood, not necessarily because of that moment, but because of the large trauma that I'd had, you know, I would not sleep very well. I'd sort of, my mind would whirl in the classroom with so many more important thoughts than maths or English or whatever it was that we were doing. There were so many big things that I was dealing with that throughout my childhood, it was just we were adrift.
And in terms of emotional support, you know, these days we would say, you know, have you taken your child to see a bereavement counsellor? Is there a charity that can help you? Have you sat your child down and discussed it? You know, what have you tried to do to address this obviously very distressed child who is wetting the bed, as you say, not eating very much, feeling very very discombobulated all the time, can't really concentrate in school? You know, what have you done? What are you doing? But when you were a little girl, that wasn't happening at all, really, was it?
No, well, we were quite lucky in the sense that we had the most wonderful family GP, and I will never forget her. She was so warm and lovely, and my dad took us along to sort of see her, and she went above and beyond. So we'd sit with her, and she'd sort of ask us, you know, how are we feeling? And obviously I'd say fine, like immediately fine, absolutely fine. Or I think I'd probably burst into tears and then sort of at some point compose myself and sort of carry on. She went above and beyond, but actually there was no proper real support like we have now with Grief Encounter. Grief Encounter is a lifeline, is an absolute lifeline for bereaved children and their families. So obviously you've got people now that are dealing with bereaved families, bereaved people of their mother or their father, who are now in a position because of COVID, who are now desperately worried that their remaining parent will also pass away. It's a really awful time for bereaved children in particular at the moment. I remember not in COVID times being very worried that my dad would get sick.
Yes.
For that, you know, that you'd sort of be completely alone. And so we know at Grief Encounter that early intervention support for the family, for the child, for teachers in schools, you know, that's something that we do too. It's really important that people get the right support at the right time.
And so if anybody's going through this right now, if you have a child or grandchild and they've lost their parent, a parent has died, as you quite rightly say, to use the right terminology, however distressing it really is, and it so very much is, what are the sorts of things that can be done to help, and what are the sorts of organisations that you might want to direct yourself towards in order to get professional advice?
Well, firstly, Grief Encounter wasn't around, you know, when I was younger. And when I found the charity, I was so grateful because they offer and do exactly what we would have needed when we were younger. So we've also been lucky to be able to tailor and adapt our services to sort of make them COVID friendly. So we've got a grief talk helpline that is national, and we'd still do e-counselling to provide one-to-one support. But we're also able to offer online art classes, online teen groups, and story time for the youngsters. So, you know, if anyone is listening that is in a position that they are struggling with their own bereavement or a bereavement that they know of that's close to them, or even if there is a widower, you know, dad in their kid's class at primary school, please, please do Google Grief Encounter and see what we offer. It is a lifeline to people that need it, and I just wish it had existed when I was five.
And I want to highlight something about what it's like to lose a parent when you're a child, because one of the things you've said is that you were so little when you last saw your mum. You were only five. So you only had a five-year-old's view of the kind of person that she was. You never got to have a relationship with her as an adult. So it was hard for you to know what she was really like. And certainly, you know, lots of people who've died, when people talk about them, either it's very, very general, you know, she was a lovely lady, which doesn't really tell you anything at all, or it becomes a kind of beatification. Oh, she was a marvellous, you know, saint of a woman. You just think, well, that can't be the whole picture. Nobody's really a saint, you know, and you just think, what I want is kind of an essence of my mum. I want a feeling of what she was like. I want to know about her humour and the perfume that she liked and what she did eat and what she didn't eat and the things that moved, you know, all of that to get a proper rounded view. So you decided to do something about it. And what did you do and what happened?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good point that you make. I was so young that I, you know, I have a sense within my mind, within my soul of what she was like. You know, I believe from what I've been told that she was a very warm person, and I love that, but I don't know what that really means in the normal real world. And so I started emailing people that may have stories about her, you know, fellow school mums and things like that. And I got some really lovely emails and messages back from people that did know her and sort of came back with some stories about how, you know, she was a great sort of cake decorator and she liked giggling and she was just very warm and used to do tea parties. And I got a sort of sense of what she was like. And at the moment, I think I have to make my peace with knowing that that's probably what I'm going to be left with. But, you know, I've got two very young boys now and I sort of live through them. You know, it's very difficult to be a young mum without a mum, and so I'm kind of trying to put myself in her mindset and kind of think maybe how she might think. I'm doing it that way.
You put that so beautifully. Thank you so much for talking to us. I know it's still, after all these years, incredibly difficult to talk about this story, so thank you very much indeed. That was Claire Richman. Pleasure. From the children's bereavement charity Grief Encounter. If you need to support a child who's been bereaved, you can find support from Grief Encounter via their website or helpline on 0808 802 0111, 0808 802 0111. The charity Winston's Wish also has some great advice for helping grieving children. And we would love to hear from you about this. If you know just how it feels, if anything did help, or if you weren't helped at all, 88291, that is the text.